In the last few decades, Israel has become one of the most important technological powers in the world. Amazingly, with a little more than 8 million inhabitants, this country has more than 4,000 tech companies. Cisco, PayPal, Google, Facebook, Apple, and Intel are only some of the many companies that develop new products in Israel. But how did such a small and turbulent country become one of the world's innovation leaders? Well, we're going to answer that question in today's video. Israel is one of the most controversial countries in the world, and in truth, it's pretty difficult to talk about it without having to refer to wars, religion, and various political conflicts. However, in this video, we're going to try. And we're going to try and shed some light on a very different side of this country. Because, dear viewer, in the last few decades, Israel has become one of the world's greatest technological powers, and this is something pretty surprising. As we mentioned, Israel has over 4,000 tech-based companies, and 80 of the largest 500 companies in the world have subsidiaries here, oriented towards research and innovation. In fact, Tel Aviv, right after Silicon Valley, is the most important technological center in the world. And although it may seem impossible given its size, Israel is the country in the world with the third most companies listed on the Nasdaq. This is only behind the United States and China. Israel has more companies listed on this market than Spain, Italy, France, Germany, and the Netherlands all put together. So, how about some specific examples? Well, here they are. At the time of this video going out, most of the next iPhone's hardware is being developed in Israel. Further, many of Google's innovations are made in Israel, and Intel, the world's leader in microchips, owes most of its success to the innovations of its Israeli subsidiary, which, by the way, has 11,000 workers and is one of the largest companies in the entire country. And, well, even Microsoft has been considered a semi-Israeli company.
It is a hub of innovation, with top-notch computer science academic institutes and revolutionary technologies.
PayPal, IBM, Cisco, Amazon, Facebook, these are the companies that we use every day, whose technology relies a lot on R&D that is done in Israel. This sector makes up more than 12% of its national GDP and half of its exports. All right, so now you might be wondering, how did they achieve such success? Now, cultural factors are usually considered here, but today we want to focus on three political keys that were essential in this process.
Yuzma.
The 1980s in Israel are remembered as a terrible decade, especially from the economic perspective. Back then, the country was going through a tough crisis. Inflation between 1980 and 1985 exceeded 100% every year. Deficit and public debt were an almost unbearable financial burden on the economy, and in general, people felt handcuffed due to excessive state intervention. To a large extent, Israel was very dependent on the help coming from different parts of the world. And even though the situation started to stabilize by the end of the 80s, right at that time, there was a massive arrival of Jewish people from different parts of the Soviet Union. In very little time, 800,000 new people arrived in the country. And now, don't forget to put some perspective on this number. In relative terms, that would be like 70 million immigrants arriving to the United States. And now the question for Israel was fairly clear. How could they generate jobs for so many people in such a depressed economy? Israel's only option was to reinvent itself. At first, the government tried to encourage the newcomers to create companies with subsidies that would promote the work of entrepreneurs. But they soon realized that this method didn't result in very prosperous companies. Immigrants had no experience in management, and they lacked commercial knowledge, and they rarely got any financing. I mean, after all, who would want to invest their money in a turbulent country like Israel? And this is when the government realized that the key was to bet on attracting international venture capital, that is, money used for new ideas and new companies. In order to do so, they came up with the Yozma program. Thanks to Yozma, the government created 10 funds of venture capital and allocated $100 million to be used under these conditions. Each fund, capable of levying 12 million private investors, would receive 8 million in public investment. In exchange, the government would keep 40% of the property, but in case the investment was successful, the inventors could get these shares from the government just by giving the government's money back with a small interest rate.
So in 10 years, all the funds that came to Israel at that time raised about $15 billion, which were invested into local companies.
So, if things worked well, the profits would be mainly for the investors, and if things didn't work so well, the government would share in the losses. Now, this might seem unfair, but the truth is that the public investment was relatively small, and also the government expected to get the losses back from the new taxes generated by these new companies and all of the jobs that they would create. The idea was to fire things up and then continue to reap the ongoing benefits. Since then, most public programs in Israel have followed this same system. And the truth is, the results, they couldn't have been any better. International money started to arrive. There was funding for almost any idea, and in the first 8 years alone, the number of funds rose from 20 to 513. As a result, Israel today has one of the best ecosystems for entrepreneurial capital in the world, and according to the last OECD data, the investment available for new companies exceeds $150 per person per year. To make a comparison of that figure, in Spain it's only about $3.5, which is a solid 40 times less. The key in this process is that venture capital doesn't just bring money. With this money also comes expertise and contacts.
Immigration.
It could be said that Israel is the country which has bet on immigration the most. One out of every three citizens has been born abroad, and 9 out of 10 are either immigrants or the children or the grandchildren of immigrants. This is an impressive migratory number that explains the growth of its population from 800,000 inhabitants in 1948 to more than 8 million today.
In this latest round of immigration, nearly 50 French Jews arrived at Tel Aviv's Ben-Gurion Airport.
So, in little more than 60 years, the population has multiplied by 10. Israel is, in fact, a political and historical exception because their founding documents, so to speak its constitution, expresses the need to have an open immigration policy. Let's examine the law of return, which is still in force today and was created in 1950.
Every Jew has the right to come to this country as an oleh. Law of return, Article 1.
And don't get this wrong, this is not a minor issue. Immigration has contributed to the economic miracle as much as any other factor. Now, no matter what populist politicians say, whose aim is often just to get votes, the wealthiest nations are usually the ones with more immigrants. Among other reasons, it's usually because immigrants have higher rates of entrepreneurship, and also because immigrants help boost international trade, especially with their countries of origin. By the way, if you are interested about immigration, I'm going to link over to some videos about that that we've put together at the end of this video.
Education.
The quality of Israeli education is almost a national hallmark. In 1918, 30 years before the founding of the State of Israel, Jewish settlers founded the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. Israel today has one of the highest rates of people with college degrees, and the country has a lot of success with fusion companies/universities. Finance for Israeli universities relies mainly on projects financed by private companies, so there are reasons for universities to collaborate with them. Further, they have achieved the best rate of business creation in the OECD.
Knowledge transfer is essential. This is taking the university and professional world closer together.
Well, so far, we've seen the main keys to success, but there are other influential factors. For example, there is the Jewish chutzpah, a tendency to question everything, something that is key in Jewish culture. The military service is also a surprising and important thing as it helps social mobilization, forcing young people from different social classes to interact. And hey, while compulsory military service isn't exactly great, it does have some positive effects in this case. Now, we could also discuss, for example, Netanyahu's reforms of 2003, which were essential to Israel's success, but I think it's better to leave that for a future video. The thing is, thanks to all of what we've discussed today, since the 1980s, Israel has doubled its population, multiplied the number of jobs by 4, and grown by an annual average rate of 4%. Today, its GDP per capita is higher than other countries like Spain or Italy. So, what do you think? Will Israel consolidate itself as the leading technological power in the world? Could its model be repeated for other countries? Let us know what you think in the comments below. And hey, if you did like this video, be sure to hit that like button below, and don't forget to subscribe for brand new videos every Monday and every Thursday. And as always, thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.
And if you want to learn more about politics and hear even more of my lovely voice, you can join us at Reconsider Media. We have a podcast at reconsidermedia.com/podcast. See you there.